Whoa, 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 whoa. Let's take it back a little bit. Long ago and far away, I'd say that's in the realm of history and geography. Now, international studies may not be the force, but it does alter the path of language. Let's take a look. Welcome back to Tour Babel. Once again, I'm your host, Sean Clark. History and geography often go hand in hand. Time passes, people relocate. It's like that time you came home from studying abroad to find that your mom had moved away and had a new job. Right. Anyways, humans live on virtually every part of the planet, besides Antarctica. However, it wasn't always like this. The so-called Cradle Civilization is located in the Middle East, more specifically between the Tigris and Euphrates rivers in modern-day Iraq, the Fertile Crescent. This area may be what the Bible calls the Garden of Eden, the source of all humanity. Around 12,000 BC, civilization started becoming something big. People were settling down, taking part in an agrarian lifestyle, and creating the foundation for humanity as we know it. They were developing basic tools, technology, farming methods, and most importantly, written and spoken language. Now, if you take a map of the world, moving to the Americas, you get this. This region basically lies at the center of the ancient world. From this region, people would be able to spread out to eventually cover all the major continents. So, what happened then? It may have happened in the same way the Tower of Babel story describes, but people developed over centuries their languages, cultures, and ethnic identities. And these changes never stopped. Why exactly? Well, I bet geography and history played a large part. Geography is a spatial analysis of the world and how mankind relates itself to it. People are arranged by natural features, but are also arranged by themselves. They're divided as much by oceans, mountain ranges, deserts, as they are by man-made borders. One way to view how geography changes language is through the effects of colonization. Colonizers such as the Spanish, the French, the Dutch, or the British all had at some point a colony or settlement in another part of the world, the Americas, Africa, or Oceania. You know the stories. Well, all these regions now speak, to some extent, the language of their past settlers, English, French, and Spanish. But this new language zone is not the same. Languages in these places take part in language segregation or isolation. Anyone can easily tell you that British English and American English are highly divergent, and French Creole would most likely make the Académie Française writhe in pain. This is language segregation. Then there are languages such as Korean. While many Asian languages share some history, Korean is a language isolate, which means it has no genealogic connection to any other language. This is linguistic isolation. Languages end up different because the contact with from other speakers is absent. To be clear though, American English and British English differ not only because of the Atlantic Ocean, but because after the American Revolution, we wanted to separate ourselves as much as we could from English convention. Colonization is also an example of how man-made geography affects language. In Africa, pre-colonization, there were no states or nations, only tribespeople. This is not to say there were one big homogenous group. Among them, there were hundreds of ethnic groups and even more languages. Enter European powers. Various countries from Europe decided to take what they considered to be unutilized land and make the native people their subjects. The Berlin Conference in 1884 split up Africa into different claims by individual powers. These would eventually become the basis for Africa's modern-day countries. The problem with this is the lines that were drawn. Europeans cared little about individual tribes, and now bound by national borders. Many tribes are either smooshed together with others or drove apart from their comrades. As a result, modern-day African nations have to deal with ethnic diversity inside their borders. The people of these countries are in constant struggle against being marginalized and losing their identity and language, especially with regards to Western influence. Anytime you have two distinct groups of people in close proximity, they're bound to compete. In Influence of Geography of Language Competition, Marco Patriarca uses a mathematical approach to view how competition and cultural spreading lead to the loss of language diversity. In real situations, the coexistence of more than one language in neighboring areas for long times is often observed. Some models, such as the AS model, describe well situations in which, after a relatively short time, only one of the competing languages survives. They use this AS model, the Abram-Strogatz model, to examine bilingual regions such as those in African countries. Their model displays three equilibrium. In two, one language dies while the other remains. The third one allows for two languages, but is unstable, meaning it may shift without warning. Nevertheless, this is only on paper. There exist many areas of the world where communities successfully operate with more than one language. Quebec, Belgium, Spain, and Switzerland, to name a few. However, these areas have sufficient interests in keeping their multilingual heritage. In African countries, many people are marginalized because they don't speak the official language of the country, leaving them out of any sort of governmental affairs. Their languages are also not taught in schools, and the speakers feel pressure to abandon their ever-diminishing way of life. After a while, these cultures and languages die out, never to be seen again. Other languages, however, win the test of time. And down I laid to list a sad tune tale, ere long espied a fickle maid full pale, tearing a paper's breaking rings the wane. Now, unless you do theater or hang around Renaissance fairs, chances are you probably won't be speaking like this. No person alive still normally uses this type of vocabulary. This comic by XKCD shows what people of the future might think of modern-day English. We find Shakespearean English to be just as silly-sounding, but it's not technically Old English. This following phrase is closer to what one might have heard around these medieval times. Isikol vipem likam hinegedalen. Okay, well, I can't really be sure about my pronunciation, but it is in fact English. Well, Anglo-Saxon to be exact. This language is spoken by the Germanic tribes around 500 AD in Northern Europe. These tribes would borrow linguistic effects from the Celts, the Norse, and the Normans, as well as others. Eventually, the Great Vowel Shift in the 15th century and later would lead to what would become modern-day English. Pretty much every language started out as something different than what it is today. It is possible to trace language roots back centuries. Romantic languages such as French, Spanish, and Italian are called so because of their Latin roots. Latin roots can be traced back even further, as shown in this diagram, to the Italic family, which goes all the way up to the Proto-Indo-European family of languages. Rvathi Krishnaswamy writes about how European philosophers first started following language paths in order to better orientate themselves in history, his main focus being the recently discovered Sanskrit. This discovery would create the basis for Europeans to explore this history of much of the East. With its claim to scientificity, the new philology, as it was then called, seemed to offer the best hope for the historian who wished to move beyond the narratives of history to a closer and more reliable examination of their materials. Language was seen as this kind of archive, where the discoveries of men are safe from any accidents, archives which are proof against fire, and which cannot be destroyed but with the total ruin of the people. Language's place in history and society is important because it allows for people to not only tell tale, but leave hints about what the world was like when it was spoken. The saying, history is written by the victors, is sadly true, and as a result, humanity probably lacks a large portion of truly explicit knowledge about the past. Luckily, our records of current history are much more detailed, particularly because almost everything we say or do gets recorded electronically. Had the internet been invented a mere 100 years earlier, we could have had brilliant insight in things such as Hitler's grand scheme in World War II. The change of language by geography overall is a touchy subject, especially since humans are bound less and less by their natural environment and more by their national borders. Today, there are very few groups who are truly isolated from the rest of the world. People now need to maintain their uniqueness and independence through borders and politics. It becomes necessary for governments to ensure that the people within their borders are not marginalized, so that their cultures and languages are preserved. However, that may just be a topic for next time. Until then, I'm Sean Clark, and this is Torah Babel. From Humboldt State University, good day.